Hello, anatomy colleagues. This is Dr. Alsup, and we will be discussing the joints in the shoulder region. And we are going to invest a little time here. So sit back, get ready, as this is a complex region and also a clinically relevant region. The mobility of the glenohumeral joint really lends to a decrease in stability. And with that decrease in stability, there's an increase in injuries or damage to this region. So it's something that comes up often in terms of many clinical practices. I want to note right off the bat that there is more than just one joint of interest in this region. And we will discuss specifics regarding these four joints or joint-like things. So much to do, so let's go ahead and get right into it. All right. There are four joints or joint-like entities that are located or affect the shoulder region. But when someone is referring to the shoulder joint, they are referring to the glenohumeral, sometimes just referred to as the shoulder joint. This is the most mobile joint in the body, but there are reliance of movement in these other three joints in order to reach that full range of motion possible at the glenohumeral. So these joints need to move as well in order to allow for that full range at the glenohumeral. So let's talk the basics of each one of these, starting with the most proximally located, and this is the sternoclavicular joint, which we have circled here. Now, we saw this joint earlier in the year when we were dissecting the thorax. This joint is formed by the articulation or the joining of the sternal or medial end of the clavicle, and that's articulating with the manubrium of the sternum. And movements of this joint will allow the clavicle to move. It'll allow it to move up. It'll allow it to move down. There'll be some slight other types of movements that also can occur here. And if you think about it, if you're moving your shoulder joint, or even if you kind of put your hand over your shoulder joint and your other hand on your clavicle, and you move your shoulder joint around, you can feel that clavicle oftentimes moving as well. So that clavicle's ability to move will allow for a greater range of motion. The next joint I want to discuss is not a true synovial joint. The scapulothoracic complex, or joint, describes the movements of the scapula on the posterior thoracic wall. So that rib cage, as well as the muscles and any connective tissue between that region. So when we think of the scapula moving up or down, or moving more anterolaterally with protraction or back towards the midline. So you see protraction here. Retraction is moving back towards the midline of the scapula. And then also, very important in terms of the shoulder joint region, you can have slight upwards or downwards rotation of the scapula, allowing for the glenoid fossa to move as well. So you could have the glenoid fossa being kind of rotated down or up. And you can see on this image here, what comes up with the glenoid cavity or the fossa? Well, it's going to be the arm. And that's going to allow for that full range of motion in terms of the shoulder joint. Muscles that have a distal attachment on the scapula will play the biggest role in these movements of the scapula. And so this includes many muscles we've discussed earlier in the year, such as the trapezius and the pectoralis minor. The serratus anterior is a very powerful muscle for this region. So these movements of the scapula, and sometimes the entirety of the scapula, will really play a role in terms of increasing that range of motion. Next, let's discuss the acromioclavicular joint, which is often abbreviated to the AC joint. However, the full name really spells out exactly which bony parts are articulating or joining. So you're going to have the acromial end, or the lateral end of the clavicle, articulating with the acromion of the scapula, forming the acromioclavicular joint. Now, this is a true synovial joint, and specifically, it is a plane type synovial joint. And plain synovial joints are typically only capable of slight movements, in this case, slight gliding or sliding type movements, which will allow the scapula to move slightly on that clavicle articulation. There are many ligaments associated with this joint, but there is one in particular we want you to be familiar with, and this is going to be the coracoclavicular ligament, which is actually a complex of two bands. So you can see that right here. Now, this is what is referred to as an extrinsic ligament, meaning that it is not just a thickening of the fibrous capsule of the acromioclavicular joint. So it's located near the joint, but is not on the joint. And it's really this ligament that serves to provide the greatest integrity and strength to the acromioclavicular joint. Now, if you've ever heard of the term shoulder separation, this is referring to injuries, particularly dislocations, of the acromioclavicular joint. So shoulder separations are AC joint related, not glenohumeral joint related, even though it certainly can have implications for range of movement or motion of the glenohumeral joint. And depending on the severity of the shoulder separation, the acromion becomes more prominent visually than what typically happens. All right, we have finally made it to the big one, the glenohumeral or true shoulder joint. And again, this joint has the distinction of being the most mobile joint of the body, so capable of all the motions that are possible at a synovial joint. But with that increased mobility, there is an important trade-off with decreased stability. So increased mobility means you typically have a decrease in terms of stability. And so there is a reason why the shoulder joint is so commonly discussed in clinical practice, as it's an area of fairly common clinical issues, be it dislocations, tendonitis, bursitis, and many, many others that will be discussed by some of your clinical lecturers. But let's take a moment to think through how cool it is that this joint can work through and do all the actions possible at a synovial joint. And there are links to videos in the written learning objectives that show an individual actually doing these actions, if that will be helpful. But we're going to discuss through these pictures here. So flexion is going to be the movement of the joint, which brings the arm into a more anterior position, but in the sagittal plane. So moving anterior, I always think if you're pointing right in front of you, pointing at something right in front of you, you are flexing your arm. This also brings up an important point. When you hear descriptions of movements of the shoulder joint, you may hear both flexion of the shoulder joint and flexion of the arm, due to the fact that you really can't move that shoulder without bringing the arm with it. So be aware that these two terms mean the same thing. Extension is going to be antagonistic or an opposing movement of flexion. And so with this, with extension, the shoulder joint and the arm is going to move in a posterior direction in the sagittal plane. Abduction is moving the arm away from the body, or moving the arm in a lateral direction in the coronal or frontal plane, whereas adduction is going to be the opposite. It's moving in a more medial direction in the coronal plane. I always think adduction adds back to the body. That always kind of helps me in terms of remembering which one is which. Now, if a joint like this one is capable of flexion, extension, abduction, and adduction, it can also circumduct, which is a complex circular movement, which is just the combination of those previously described movements to move the arm in a circular direction. So this is showing circumduction here, and it can start up in this region here. Lastly, the glenohumeral joint is capable of both medial and lateral rotation. Medial rotation, sometimes referred to as internal rotation, rotates the anterior surface of the humerus towards the medial towards the median plane, excuse me. So think rotating along the humerus's longitudinal axis. Whereas lateral rotation or external rotation is the opposing movement, with the anterior surface of the humerus rotating away from the median plane. So that was a lot of movement fun, and I purposely spent some time there as these actions take a little time to get used to, but you will begin to feel more comfortable as we work through the musculoskeletal content with those terms. Now, a bit about the composition of the glenohumeral joint. Part of the reason for the noted mobility that we keep discussing is the fit of the articulating bones. So you have this relatively large humeral head that is going to fit into this relatively shallow glenoid fossa. So they don't fit particularly well together. If there was a tighter fit, there would be decreased mobility, like we will see in other joints. Some bones fit really well together, and some don't, and that facilitates a little bit more movement. Almost completely encircling the joint is a musculotendinous ring, so the muscle bellies as well as the tendons of the muscles that are of the rotator cuff. All right, so the rotator cuff muscles, bellies, as well as their tendons will almost completely encircle the shoulder joint. Now, we'll have a whole learning objective on the specifics of the rotator cuff, but a few things I want to note specifically in this conversation here is that the rotator cuff is the dominant source of stability of the glenohumeral joint. So less dependent on ligaments, even though there certainly are ligaments and many of them associated with this region, but it's really those closely aligned and close geographically rotator cuffs, cuff muscles that are forming a lot of the stability. And again, I mentioned it almost completely encircles the shoulder joint, both in terms of the muscle bellies as well as the tendons, but there is an inferior deficiency, and this makes this region of the shoulder joint, this inferior region of the shoulder joint, inherently weaker. And it is in an inferior direction that most shoulder dislocations occur. But I want to note that clinically, they're very rarely described as inferior dislocations. It's often sometimes implied. It's almost always referred to as either an anterior dislocation, which is the most common type, or a posterior dislocation. So it's describing where that humeral head will end up. Is it going to end up more anterior or more posterior than normal after that dislocation? Let's spend a little time discussing this area located just superior to the glenohumeral joint, referred to as the coracoacromial arch. And this is going to be formed by the coracoid process of the scapula, as well as the acromion, or the acromion process of the scapula. And these two structures are joined by the coracoacromial ligament. So you can see that it's forming this arch over the superior portion of the glenohumeral joint. And it really plays a protective role, particularly in terms of preventing superior dislocations. However, think about full abduction or full flexion of the arm in terms of the most range of motion that can occur there. And you can think about how some of the structures that are located in this region actually come in close contact, if not actually touch or impinge or are impinged upon within this arch. So one of the most dominant structures that will run through this region is going to be the tendon of the supraspinatus muscle. And this is one of the rotator cuff muscles. So repetitive actions, particularly in that full flexion or full abduction over and over again, could lead to this tendon kind of being pinched up against the coracoacromial arch, which could lead to tendonitis or other injuries such as rupture. In fact, based on this location, the supraspinatus tendon is the most commonly injured rotator cuff muscle. So we will come back to this quite often throughout our time in musculoskeletal anatomy. There is also a bursa located in this region that is going to help to reduce the friction that is happening in this region between the coracoacromial arch and the glenohumeral joint. And this is referred to as the subacromial bursa, sometimes referred to as the subdeltoid. But it too, like any bursa, can become inflamed, and bursitis can develop in this region as well. But this is an important bursa that we do want you to be aware of. Lastly, before we finish, I want to discuss one more structure associated with this joint, which is the glenoid labrum. And really, we have it labeled here in just this one area, but it will extend kind of throughout. It will circumscribe the glenoid fossa. And it's really going to help to provide a better fit for that humeral head. So it's kind of slightly deepening the glenoid fossa to allow for a better fit with the humeral head. Recall in our discussions in the last session that labra are only really associated with ball and socket joints, and the shoulder joint is one of the two major ball and socket joints in the body, with the hip joint being the other. All right, excellent. I know this was a longer one, but this time is well worth it, as this region is a clinically important one. Also note that we have covered the foundations of this area. So foundations is key. There are numerous ligaments and numerous tendons and numerous bursae that we did not discuss, but we have intentionally pulled the most foundational, clinically important areas of this region. I thank you for your time and attention here, and I hope you have a great rest of your day.